everyone. My name is Diana Mercuri. I'm with Mancuso Show Management. And this morning I am presenting an interview that I did with David Owen Hastings. David is teaching this week at our World Quilt Show online and is also teaching online upcoming at our Pennsylvania National Quilt Extravaganza, the online part. David is one of my favorite instructors. He's so nice, and he's also super talented. He is a quilter, a graphic designer, and a print and textile artist. And he also was the former president of the Seattle Modern Quilt Guild. He creates temporary and art and modern minimal quilt textile designs. His creative approach is really about to modern quilting has given him the opportunity to teach a lot of his techniques and show his love for the Japanese culture. I really hope that you enjoy this interview. Thanks so much. Hi, David. How are you today?
I'm doing great. Thank you, Diana.
Great. So where are you Zooming from today?
Well, I'm Zooming from our rental house. My husband and I moved from the Seattle area this past December to a little tiny town. It's called Squim. Most people look at that name and they pronounce it Sequim, but it's Squim. And it's on the Olympic Peninsula in Washington State. So we're kind of halfway between Seattle and the Pacific Ocean.
Oh my gosh, it sounds beautiful.
Yeah, it's really pretty. It's really cool right now because Squim is in this little rain shadow, which is protected by the Olympic mountain range. And we get very, very little rain here compared to the rest of this corner of the state. So it's kind of like a Mediterranean climate, and we have lavender fields everywhere. So this is kind of a tourist draw right now is lavender season. People are flocking here to go, you know, walk amongst the fields and take photos and buy lavender, this and that. So it's kind of fun right now.
Oh my gosh, to live that here. Sounds magical.
Yeah, it's neat.
So why don't we start today by talking about your background? Can you give us a little bit of detail about your background?
Yeah, well, I grew up in Iowa, so I wasn't a farm boy. My dad was a doctor, but I grew up with cows and fields all around me all the time. And I've always been super, you know, creative, making things since I could basically put, you know, a popsicle stick with a pipe cleaner. And my parents really encouraged all of us kids to be creative and try things. And I really took to sewing and knitting in particular. So I learned how to knit when I was about 7, and I haven't stopped knitting. And then one of my grandmas helped me learn how to use our sewing machine. So I started out by making clothes for my G.I. Joe dolls, which is kind of funny to think back on. But I've always loved to make things, and it's just a pleasure to do things with your hands, create something, as you know, as all sewists know. You know, it's very fun. It's been a lifelong passion.
That's awesome. So what sewing machine did your grandmother have? Do you remember?
Yeah, I have it. I still use it. It's an old Singer. It's I'm not sure what the model is called, but it's the color of a Band-Aid, and it's about 1950 something. And weighs about 5 tons. And so it was kind of like the sewing machine that came after the featherweights. It was like more robust. Anyway, I use that one now to do my stitched paper artwork, which I think you're gonna show some pictures of that a little bit later here.
That's awesome that you still have it.
Yeah.
So did you go to school for creative field?
You know, originally, no, I actually was going to be a pharmacologist, which just sounds totally odd. But I had a real interest in science and medical science in particular. And I spent summers between all my high school years doing research at the University of Iowa in Iowa City. And then I just decided once I started that path in my education that I was more interested in the creative side of things than the scientific, although there's a lot of, you know, creativity in that too. But I switched to graphic design as my major in college. And so that's what I'm trained as a graphic designer.
Awesome. Well, of course, that does lead into maybe how you got into textile arts, but why don't you talk a little bit about that, how you got into quilting and things like that.
Right. Sure. Yeah. In college, you know, I studied graphic design, but I always was taking these little, you know, side courses and things. And I had a couple of really great, very kind of experimental textile instructors in school. You know, we would make things out of cut up rubber inner tubes and, you know, just all kinds of strange materials. It was like the, you know, the found material challenge before Project Runway came about. And anyway, so, you know, I just, because I've always loved making things, putting things together with stitches was always the way I did it. You know, it just, it's immediate, you know, it's not, you don't have to wait for glue to dry. So stitching has always been a part of, you know, how I put things together. And it just evolved over the years. I dabbled in quilting, you know, from high school time until current time. And I didn't get really serious about it until about 5 or 6 years ago, I think it was. And then there's something that happened. I think it was a combination of the modern quilting movement starting up. And then also fabric got way better all of a sudden for some reason. And I don't know the ins and outs or why, but technology to print fabric and produce beautiful fabric got way better. So that kind of brought me back into quilting. And so now that's kind of my primary medium.
Nice. Have you always been drawn more to the modern quilt, you know, technique and movement?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. In fact, when I started to get really serious about quilting, I joined three different quilt guilds all at once. One was the Modern Quilt Guild, one was more like an art quilt guild, and one was more traditional, just to kind of like find out, you know, where do I belong? What appeals to me the most? And I think it was the, you know, the clean lines, the simplicity, the quiet simplicity of modern quilting that really drew me in. So that's kind of my focus. Although I still feel like I'm somewhere on the fence between, you know, art quilting and modern quilting. And sometimes there's even something traditional in there. So I'm okay with not having to label myself, you know, one thing or another.
Which is great about art itself is that you don't have to label yourself, that you can like whatever you want to like, and even a combination of that.
True.
You also are very drawn to Japanese inspired quilting and quilts.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah. This is an unexplainable thing for me, but ever since I was a small kid, I've always been drawn to Japan and Japanese culture, the music, the food, the crafts, everything, and the language. And so as I got to be an adult, then I got to pursue that more. I've been to Japan a couple of times. One time was to spend a month there to really learn about shibori and in dyeing with natural indigo. So I've gotten to, you know, feed my inner Japanese soul a little bit by visiting the country and exploring the crafts and sharing what I love about them with other people. And I also think there's a very nice kind of modern simplicity, a synergy with modern quilting between the Japanese aesthetic in general and modern quilting, if they seem to go together well.
Yeah, I agree with that. What was your favorite part of Japan?
Oh gosh, that's like a hard one. I think, you know, my mind just immediately went to food because I love cooking and eating. So Osaka is like the food capital of the country. And I just had a blast eating my way through the streets of Osaka. I met some wonderful people, shared some good meals with some interesting folks. And that's really, I think, what travel's all about, is connecting with people, you know, not from your culture, but you have commonalities. And I really enjoy that part of aspect of travel.
That sounds like an amazing couple of trips for sure.
Yeah.
Well, so at our World Quilt Show here, you are teaching two workshops inspired by architecture and the Indigo Modern. Can you tell us a little bit about those workshops and what students could expect to learn in those workshops?
Yeah, of course. So Inspired by Architecture is really fun. It's been one of my most popular workshops that I give. What we basically do is take architectural photographs that either I supply or the students bring their own that they would like to work with. And I show the students how to kind of isolate down and really crop in on small details of the architectural elements. And then I show them how to translate that into a fabric quilt. And we're going to use the quilt as you go method. We're going to build the quilt right on the batting. And then I will share my ideas for machine quilting with the walking foot. And this is, to me, it's one of the most important design elements of a quilt is the quilting itself. And I think of my quilt, my sewing machine is basically a big drawing tool. You know, I'm drawing with thread on top of the quilt layers and creating this whole additional layer of design on the quilt surface. So that's inspired by architecture. And then the other one that I'm doing at that show, remind
Is
me,
mini is the
mini
Indigo Modern.
Indigo Modern. Thank you. Sorry, I got so it's
You're
caught up
teaching
in
just so often
no,
for us.
I know it's that's true. So Indigo Modern, that I developed that course because I've been in so many workshops with fellow textile artists who do all this dyeing with indigo. They do shibori dyeing or what have you, and they end up with all this fabric and then they don't do anything with it. So I wanted to make a class where I could show people how to put that beautiful blue and white palette to work. And so what I do in that class is we first stitch some little paper maquettes, I call them. They're little paper studies, and we work with blue and white paper and make little compositions and explore how the blocks can come together. And then we translate those ideas to fabric and stitch with blue and white fabric, either any commercial fabric that's blue and white, or I have a great resource for yukata cotton from Japan that's in that blue and white palette. And actually, this quilt behind me, I'm going to lean this way, is kind of a 2.0 version of that class. It's the same concepts of doing a very simple block design, working with blue and white primarily, and then making this modern kind of composition that looks very, very on trend and beautiful. So.
I love the blue and white, and I know that indigo and shibori are still very hot right now. So that's great that you can kind of take those dyed fabrics that people have been dyeing, the indigo dyeing, and you put it into a quilt.
I see blue and white from Japan all over in home decor and all kinds of different industries. I've purchased multiple shirts from Target that are reproductions of shibori patterns. And anyway, it's kind of funny that it's become so prolific. And I think it's just there's just something very appealing about that palette to a lot of people.
I totally agree. And I do, I've seen things at Target too. That's funny that you mentioned that. It's kind of funny how things like that become so main, mainstream. And sometimes I think there's like even high designers that are like quilting with quilting jackets. That be kind of was a big name designers, kind of incorporating these kind of traditional patterns, traditional quilts, like into these big fashion items, which I think is interesting.
And my goal is to, well, first of all, to help people develop their design skills. That's my main goal in teaching, but also to appreciate other cultures. So if I can create some additional appreciation for where this fabric came from, the culture that it comes from, and have the students support that directly somehow with their either with their dollars or with their knowledge. That's just really great when that happens, when that it all comes together. So,
Oh, that's so great. Well, you're also teaching for us at our upcoming Pennsylvania National Quilt Extravaganza online that is happening after the live in-person show. The week of that teaching is September 22nd to the 24th. And you are scheduled to teach Inspired by Art on Thursday, September 23rd, and Mini Mid-Mod Quilts on Friday from 12 to 3, that's September 24th. Can you tell us a little bit about those workshops?
So Inspired by Art is really fun. It's my most artistic approach to quilting that I teach. It's very freeing. Again, we kind of like with Inspired by Architecture, I have my students pick a piece of artwork that they might like to work with as their jumping off point. And then we do a little creative exercise, a little creative writing to just observe what we're seeing in their piece of work. You know, how it makes them feel, the colors, the physical shapes they're seeing. And then I talk through them through the process to develop a set of simple block designs based on what they're seeing or what their perception of this piece of artwork is and how they can kind of incorporate that into a modern, minimal sort of abstract design. So it's very fun. And people seem to really enjoy that process because, you know, there seems to be some kind of a mystique about art where, you know, people are afraid to claim, you know, ooh, I'm not really an artist, you know, kind of, but really I think of all quilters as artists. They're mm-hmm. all creating something new that nobody's ever seen before. And I think it's just a matter of giving people the confidence and the space to kind of explore things on their own and develop their own ideas.
Sounds very therapeutic.
Yeah. Yeah, mm-hmm. it is. It's one of my most touchy-feely workshops that I give. Mm-hmm. And then mini mid-mod quilts is, that's my, also one of my super popular ones with Inspired by Architecture. We do these little tiny mini quilts based on mid-century modern design aesthetic. And we work with a very simple palette. I encourage my students to choose a neutral color that they're going to work with, and then pair a kind of a bright pop of color with it. And we make these little tiny compositions. They're only 5 inches square. And in that 3-hour class, most students can finish 4 to 6 of these little guys. And then they all tell me, this is very addictive. I can't stop making these things.
Yeah.
Also, if you can show me for a second, I can also show my students how to stitch them together into a small composition. So this mm-hmm. is a bunch of 5-inch blocks that have been joined together with this gusset seam technique that I use. And it's got this wonderful hand stitching on it too, that mm-hmm. is inspired by Japan, of course. So I'm kind of mixing things that I love into one project. And I think it's a lot of fun. It's been very popular.
Yes, definitely one of my favorites to see. I love that class. Well, to let everybody know out there that who's watching, that if you're interested in taking either of David's workshops at Pennsylvania, there are still spaces available. You just need to go to www.quiltfest.com and go to the Pennsylvania show, go to the virtual workshops and search by instructor for David Owen Hastings. David, you're currently building your new house. You had mentioned that before.
Yes.
In Seattle, in Squim.
And yes.
You're going to have a brand new studio. What's it going to look like?
It's going to be, for me, it's going to be amazing. Because right now you're only seeing this beautiful setup that I've created. But, you know, this is a very humble, like 12 by 12 bedroom that I'm working in today. But,
right.
but my new studio, it's going to be 15 by 21 feet, which seems enormous to me. And I will be able to have multiple sewing machines set up. I'll have my sit down long arm. And then the wonderful thing about it is that it's right next to a dairy farm that is a protected historic site. So I will look out of my windows at these beautiful Holstein dairy cows just right across the street. And I'm very happy about that because I grew up with cows all around me. And it feels like a little bit of home, except that Iowa didn't necessarily have a mountain range in the distance like we do here. So
it's going to be great. Beautiful. That sounds so nice. Is there
sometime?
Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, sometime next year it will be finished. It's been very slow going because construction is all, you know, backed up with the delays of COVID and everything. But anyway, we're being patient. Sort of.
That's good. Yes. You have patience, you know, and then the reward will come for sure.
Yes.
So is there something in the studio that's like a special, are you going to have like a design wall or a special, you know, rack, you know, type of thing that, that you've seen that other studios have that you're just like, I gotta have that.
Yes. Well, I definitely need a design wall that I can walk up to that's going to be floor to ceiling. And I've got one wall set aside for that. I will have two walls with big windows, big double hung windows that I can fling open because the climate here is so mild. You know, we can have windows open for more than half the year, so that's going to be lovely. And then I've got a great like a walk-in storage area, so I can have all my excess fabric stash and everything beautifully displayed, but not necessarily out in my workspace. And I'm a very tidy person. People laugh at me when they come into my studio. They think it looks a bit like an operating room because I'm a little bit tidy. But you know, that keeps things clear for my mind, you know, so that I'm only focusing on what is going on my table right at the moment.
That's pretty nice, though, to have that
Yeah.
closet where you can kind of just like, put all the things,
Yes.
that won't be distracting to you in your workspace. That's
Yes. Yeah.
that'll, yeah, that sounds wonderful. Well, I'm excited to see pictures of one when it's done. You'll
Yeah, we'll have to do
have to send
a
them
little
over.
studio tour when it's
Yes,
finished.
absolutely, absolutely. So what are you working, what new projects are you working on now?
Yeah, well, this is the one that's been taking up my time recently. That's behind me, this big quilt. It's a king size quilt, a commission that I'm doing for friends that live in Arizona, and they just said, you know, it's like my ideal clients. They just said we want something with blue and some cobalt blue in there, and yeah, just have at it. So,
Nice.
I showed it to them this past Sunday on FaceTime, and they were thrilled. They're very excited to see it. So,
That's
trying to I'm I had my this is a something all quilters can relate to. I had almost the next to the last row sewn together. You know, it gets a little unwieldy when it gets this big, and then realized I had sewn the rows the opposite way that I wanted them. You know, the wrong one. It's I had to rip out a hole, you know, like a 9 foot long seam, but that's okay. Now
Yes.
I've done
Oh
that,
my
and I
gosh.
don't have to make any more mistakes on it.
Now you can tell your clients that really blood, sweat, and tears went into
Yes, exactly. In fact, I did bleed a little bit, but I didn't bleed on it. Thank goodness.
that. That's good. Well, do you have any other hobbies? What do you do when you're not quilting?
Yeah, well, that's a great question. When am I not quilting or teaching? I still do work full time as a graphic designer. So I work only with nonprofits on their branding and their fundraising materials. So that definitely takes up a good chunk of time. And then creating samples and new classes. I meant to take all of this August and September off so I could really focus on my new material, but you guys talked me into teaching, and I'm totally okay with that. But I do have this long laundry list of new workshops that I want to work on, and I'm so energized by that. So really, when I'm not eating or sleeping or walking our dog, I am thinking about the next creative project, and it's been a really fun time. It's like a self-imposed like retreat or something that the pandemic has caused. So I've got all this extra time without the social obligations, and I don't have to feel guilty about just focusing on my art. So that's fun.
That's nice. I think a lot of quilters out there would agree with you on that.
Yeah.
And we're definitely excited to see what new material you have for us next year.
Yeah. Yeah.
But thank you so much for joining me
You're very
today.
welcome.
It was
Thank
so
you.
great. It was so great to talk to you today. I just
Likewise.
want to mention again, if you are interested in signing up for David Owen Hastings workshops, virtual workshops at Pennsylvania National Quilt Extravaganza online, you just need to go to www.quiltfest.com. All right, David, thank you so much. Talk to you
All
soon.
right. Take care.
Hi, everybody. I hope you enjoyed that great interview with David Owen Hastings. He's definitely a cool guy, and you should check his classes out for the Pennsylvania National Quilt Extravaganza online. Upcoming next, we have the lecture with Kay Fassett. So if you've purchased a ticket, you are Welcome to join us at 1 p.m. Keith will be here online. And then coming up at 2 p.m. is David's interview with Jess Cook Whitley, and she's from Burn Sewing Connection, who is one of our sponsors for Pennsylvania. Thanks so much, and I'll see you soon.